That shaped the Broadway musical theater. We've been talking about bad guys, and going back to 2001, two of the greatest bad guys ever to grace the musical stage are happened to be Leo and Max and the Producers. Of course, the story about how you can make more money out of a flop than out of a hit goes back to the 1967 cult film The Producers. Mel Brooks always loved this movie, and it was Mel Brooks' commentary at the time on Cabaret. No one could believe, Mel Brooks couldn't believe that a musical written about the rise of the Nazis could become the success that it did. And he based the Producers in part upon that concept, which now Cabaret has become one of the great classics. But the Producers took no prisoners. It insulted everybody, did it on purpose, and Max and Leo certainly were among the best.
The time has come to be a lover from the Argentine, to slick my hair down with brilliant tine and goggle heavily with Lister. Wow! It's time for Max to put his backers on their backs and thrill them with amazing acts. Those aging nymphomaniacs. They were helpless, they were hopeless. Then along came Billy. They were joyless, they were boyless. Then along came Billy. They're my angel, I'm their devil, and I keep those embers aglow. When I woos 'em, I can't lose 'em, 'cause I guess my spell and they start yelling fire down below. So romantic, they were frantic. Then their prayers were heard up above. Heaven sent them their Bialy. I'm the celebration of love. It's Max Bialystock.
Oh!
Oh,
next. What?
I've done it. I've raised the $2 million.
Now all we have to do is put on the biggest flop in history.
That's great!
Well, those are two bad guys taking advantage of all those little old ladies. Another bad character that's just wonderful to play is Mrs. Mears in Thoroughly Modern Millie. Adapted from the movie, the script was rewritten quite somewhat, and Gene Tesori added music to that. And then we get to the next really interesting bad characters, Velma Von Tussle in Hairspray, the musical with music written by Mark Shaiman and, my God, just went right out of my head. Sorry about that, people. But Hairspray is the great classic story, again, written by Harvey Fiske, Shaiman and Whitman. And it's the classic story of how racism and being an outsider felt in Baltimore in 1962. Harvey Fierstein really likes to write scripts based upon people who are outside of the norm and what it means to be outside of the norm, and Hairspray done in great satire.
Back step, cha-cha-cha, side step, front step, back and turn. Front step, cha-cha-cha, Tammy Sharper, side step, front step, back again, front step.
Oh my God, Penny, there's Link. Step, Link, Penny, pinch me. Front step, again. 22. I can't believe I'm really here auditioning. I can't believe I'm really here watching you audition.
Front step, cha-cha-cha, back step, cha-cha-cha, side step, front step, back, and to, oh, Amber, look at this motley crew. Oh, this town sure has gone downhill since I was crowned Miss Baltimore Grass. Oh, my God, how times have changed. These girls must be blind or completely deranged. But time seemed to halt when I was Miss Baltimore Grass. Amber, that move is far too dirty.
Mother, wake up from that dream of yours. This isn't 1930.
You can laugh, but life's a test. Don't do this, don't do that, remember. Mother knows best for the crowns and the vaults from when I won Miss Baltimore Grass.
That's a perfect family mission.
Let me show you how your mommy dear took out the competition. Girls, go get them. Boys, let's rumba. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Those poor runner-ups might still hold some grudges. They powdered their cups, but I screwed the judges. Those broads thought they'd win if a plate they would spin in their dance. Not a chance. Boys, put me down. Oh, good morning, ladies. Let's see what you got.
Twist, 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 twist. Mashed potato mambo.
Ready? Begin. On my show, you'll never find a thrusting hip or bumping bum.
What's that, dance for fleas and ticks?
Oh, you should have seen my bag of tricks. Oh, I hit the stage, but tongs are blazed. Well, belting, I eat, I'm preparing souffles. But that triple somersault is how I clinched Miss Baltimore Crab.
Live?
No, I'm sure I can call.
Well, this show isn't broadcasted.
CinemaScope!
I never drank one chocolate malt. No desserts for Miss Baltimore Grabs.
This one will never get a date in those hand-me-down clothes.
Ah, kid, she'll never get a date if Daddy buys her a new nose. I would say, oink a malt, if I wasn't Miss Baltimore Grabs.
Like you dress.
Amber, there's no need to be cruel.
Would you swim in an integrated pool?
I sure would. I'm all for integration. It's the new frontier.
Not in Baltimore, it isn't. And may I be frank? First impressions can be tough, and when I saw you, I knew it. If your size weren't enough, your last answer just blew it. And so, my dear, so short and stout, you'll never be
meant your face. Oh, well, it isn't your fault. You're just down with a case of Miss Baltimore Krebs. You may go.
Thank you.
Well, now that's a bad guy for you. She's racist. She's everything that you can imagine. And of course, this is what Harvey Weinstein really wanted to prove. Then we have the wicked stepsisters in Cinderella, who do everything they can in the Rodgers and Hammerstein version to keep Cinderella down and to try to snag the prince for himself. These are the original wicked stepsisters, Alice Ghostly and Kay Ballard, from the 1957 televised Julie Andrews version.
Why would a fellow want a girl like her, a frail and fluffy beauty? Why can't a fella ever once prefer a solid girl like me?
She's a frothy little bubble with a flimsy kind of charm, and with very little trouble I could break her little arm.
Oh, why would a fella want a girl like her, so obviously unusual? Why can't a fella ever once prefer a usual girl like me?
Her cheeks are a pretty shade of pink, but not any pinker than a rose is. Their skin may be delicate and soft, but not any softer than a doe is. Her neck is no whiter than a swan.
She's only as dainty as a daisy.
She's only as graceful as a bird. So why is the fella going crazy?
Oh, why would a fella want a girl like her? A girl who's merely lovely. Why can't a fella ever once prefer a girl who's nearly me? What's the matter with the man? What's the matter with the man? What's the matter with the man?
And they're wonderful. And of course, in the original, this was all filmed live. And these were all Broadway performers who were used to filming live. Of course, the stage version that was redone added an additional music from the Rodgers and Hammerstein portfolio that was not familiar, so they could fill it out. And Laura Osnes was the original Cinderella. Miss Trunchbull, the original Matilda hit bad guy, the headmaster of the school, on stage in the Broadway version, she was played and dragged by a man. It's not really necessary to do that. It was sort of gimmicky, and in the movie, it was not done that way, but certainly was interesting. But then we have maybe one of the ultimate bad guys, Aaron Burr in Hamilton. You know, if it weren't for him, what would have happened to Alexander Hamilton? And of course, you know, they had the duel in New Jersey because at the time, as they say in the play, everything was legal in New Jersey.
Ah, Mr. Secretary.
Mr. Burr, sir.
And did you hear the news about good old General Mercer?
No.
You know Claremont Street?
Yeah.
They renamed it after him. The Mercer legacy is secure.
Sure.
And all he had to do was die.
Yeah, that's a lot less work.
We ought to give it a try. Now, how you gonna get your debt plan through?
I guess I'm gonna finally have to listen to you.
Really?
Talk less. Smile more. Do whatever it takes to get my plan on the Congress floor.
The Madison and Jefferson are merciless.
Well, hate the sin, love the sinner.
Hamilton.
I'm sorry, Burr, I gotta go.
But
decisions are happening over dinner.
Two Virginians and an immigrant walk into a room.
Diametrically opposed foes.
They emerge with a compromise, having opened doors that were
previously closed. Bros.
The immigrant emerges with unprecedented financial power, a system he can shape however he wants. The Virginians emerge with the nation's capital. And here's the pièce de résistance. No one else was in the room where it happened, the room where it happened, the room where it happened. No one else was in the room where it happened, the room where it happened, the room where it happened. No one really knows how the game is played, the art of the trade, how the sausage gets made. We just assume that it happens.
We just assume that it happens.
Two Virginians and an immigrant walk into a room, diametrically opposed foes. They emerge with a compromise, having opened doors that were previously closed. The immigrant emerges with unprecedented financial power, a system he can shape however he wants. The Virginians emerge with the nation's capital. And here's the pièce de résistance. No one else was in the room where it happened, the room where it happened, the room where it happened. No one else was in the room where it happened, the room where it happened, the room where it happened. No one really knows how the game is played, the art of the trade, how the sausage gets made. We just assume that it happens, but no one else is in the room where it happens.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the show.
More than that, you gotta be kidding. But in any event, you get the sense. Playing Aaron Burr, I think, is almost more fun than playing Alexander Hamilton. Aaron Burr is just so complex, and not that Alexander Hamilton isn't, but you know, what would create jealousy to the degree that Aaron Burr had it to be willing to actually duel with Alexander Hamilton? So now let's get into some more great parts. You know, again, if you're going to choose a part to play, it's not always the lead. And in the case of the second lead, sometimes you have a far better time. And in the case of Oklahoma, Aduane is certainly a fabulous part to get because she's got all kinds of problems.
It ain't so much a question of not knowing what to do. I know what's right and wrong since I've been 10. I heard a lot of stories and I reckon they are true about how girls are put upon by men. I know I mustn't fall into the pit, but when I'm with a feller, I forget. Oh, I'm just a girl who can't say no. I'm in a terrible fix. Always say, come on, let's go. Just when I order St. Nick's. When a person tries to kiss a girl, I know she ought to give his face a smack. But as soon as someone kisses me, I somehow sort of want to kiss him back. I'm just a fool when lights are low. I can't be prissy and quaint. What you gonna do? Supposing that he says that your lips are like cherries or roses or berries. What you gonna do? Supposing that he says that you're sweeter than cream and he's gotta have cream or die. What you gonna do when he talks that way? Spit in his eye? And then I think of that old golden rule and do for him what he would do for me. I can't resist a Romeo in a sombrero and chaps. Soon as I sit on their laps, something inside of me snaps. I can't say no.
Well, Will Park is another great part. And, you know, one of the things about the way Rodgers and Hammerstein constructed their plays, the primary couple and the secondary couple The secondary couple was often meant to be comic relief, and in the case of Oklahoma, where you have serious adult issues on the table, let's forget about who's going to the picnic, but it is a story of maturation, coming of age, and, you know, true sexual conflict. And, you know, Will Parker, not the brightest bulb in the chandelier, but he certainly knows what he wants and is trying to get it.
But I sure did see some things I'd never seen before. I got to Kansas City on a Friday. By Saturday, I learned a thing or two. 'Cause up till then, I didn't have an idea of what the modern world was coming to. I counted 20 gas buggies going by themselves almost every time I took a walk. Then I put my ear to a bell telephone and a strange woman started in to talk.
What next?
Yeah, what?
What next? Everything's up to date in Kansas City. They've gone about as far as they can go. They went and built a skyscraper 7 stories high, about as high as a building ought to grow. Everything's like a dream in Kansas City. It's better than a magic lantern show. You can turn the radiator on whenever you want some heat. With every kind of comfort, every house is all complete. You can walk to privies in the rain and never wet your feet. They've gone about as far as they can go.
Yes, sir!
Gone about as far as they can go. Everything's up to date in Kansas City. They've gone about as far as they can go. They got a big theater they call a Burlicue. For 50 cents you can see a dandy show. One of the girls was fat and pink and pretty. Was round above, but she was round below. I could swear that she was padded from a shoulder to a heel. But later in the second act when she began to peel, she proved that everything she had was absolutely real. She
went about as far as she could go.
Yes, sir!
It's only dancing nowadays, the waltz is through. Catch on to it, a 1 and a 2, a 1 and a 2. Cause they don't do it alone. Come on, Al!
Damn, that's about as far as I can go.
She's so fancy, Anna. Whoa! Look at my shoes, Emma.
She got a great smile.
That's a classic.
And this was from the Hugh Jackman version from the National Theatre of London, which played in theaters last week. And you know, Will Parker's just a great, great part. Then you have poor beleaguered Miss Adelaide. You know, she, another great part. And in Guys and Dolls, the construction of the play is so unusual because all four leads are equal. And as a matter of fact, Miss Adelaide is the bigger part to Sarah Brown. and certainly I'd rather be Miss Adelaide than Sarah Brown any day of the week. But of course, I'd... I'm going to stop it for a second. You know, those of you who went to London with me saw the new immersive Guys and Dolls, where the audience is actually part of the action. And the British do a thing with staging now that's really quite interesting. They involve the audiences. They did it last year in a Fiddler on the Roof production in the cabaret that they're doing right now. The audience is part of the action. Here Lies Love, which just opened in New York with rave reviews. I'm going to be announcing a November date of that. The audience is part of it. They feel that it shouldn't just be a fourth wall. The audience should be able to participate. This is the 1992 revival of Guys and Dolls. It actually launched a few careers. Peter Gallagher, Nathan Lane, and Faith Prince. very deceptive. You know, you think it's a nightclub act, but it's really talking about how she feels about...
It says here, the average unmarried female, basically insecure, due to some long frustration, may react with psychosomatic symptoms difficult to endure, affecting the upper respiratory tract. In other words, just from waiting around for that plain little band of gold, a person can develop a cold. You can spray her wherever you figure the streptococci lurk. You can give her a shot for whatever she's got, but it just won't work. If she's tired of getting the fisheye from the hotel clerk, a person can develop a cold. It says here, the female remaining single, just in the legal sense, shows an erotic tendency, see note, tendency, see note. Oh, see note, note. Oh, well, here we go. I like that. Chronic organic syndromes. Or hypertense involving the eye, the ear, the nose, and throat. In other words, just from worrying whether the wedding is on or off, a person can develop a cough. You can feed her all day with the vitamin A and the bromofizz, but the medicine never gets anywhere near where the trouble is. If she's getting a kind of a name for herself and the name ain't his, a person can develop a cough. Furthermore, just from stalling and stalling and stalling the wedding trip, a person can develop la grip, la posa nasal drip with the wheezes. From a lack of community property and a feeling she's getting too old, a person can develop a bad, bad cold.
Fabulous Miss Adelaide.
You are. Don't. What are you doing? You're
where's
Nathan? That's what I'm doing. I'm supposed to bring Miss Adelaide a message from him. I wish Nathan would bring his own messages.
He bought me the fur thing 5 winters ago, and the gown the following fall. From the necklace, the bag, the hat, and the shoes. Oh, what generous gifts I recall. Then last night, in his apartment, he tried to remove them all. And I said, as I ran down the hall, take back your mink, take back your pearls. What made you think that I was one of those girls? Take back the gown, the shoes, and the hat. I may be down, but I'm not flat as all that. I thought that each expensive gift you'd arrange was a token of your esteem. Now when I think of what you want in exchange, it all seems a horrible dream. So take back your mink to from whence it came, and tell them to shorten the sleeves for some other day.
is the other great supporting role in Guys and Dolls? If you're not going to be Nathan Detroit or Skye Masterson, I think I'd almost rather be Nicely Nicely Johnson. Let me explain how the song was written, because that might explain why Nicely Nicely Johnson gets so elevated. When Guys and Dolls was originally written, Sam Levine was cast in the part. They knew who they wanted to play these people, didn't bother to audition any of them. And when it came time for Sam Levine to learn the song, Sit Down, You're Rocking the Boat, they found out he couldn't sing it, and they didn't want to give up the song, so they had to look around in the scene to figure out who else could they give it to. So Sam Levine, who was originally cast as Nathan Detroit, couldn't do it, and it elevates the part of Nicely Nicely Johnson.
I would like to welcome you gentlemen to the Save a Soul mission.
Hey, come on!
The meeting will be conducted by the head of our organization, General Cartwright.
We will now hear testimony from Brother Nicely Nicely Johnson. Brother Nicely Nicely Johnson!
It happened to be kind of funny. Like a dream.
A dream!
That's it, a dream!
Tell us in your own words.
I dreamed last night I got on the boat to heaven, and by some chance I had brought my dice along. And there I stood, and I hollered, someone fade me. But the passengers, they knew right from wrong. For the people all said, sit down. Sit down, you're rocking the boat.
People all said, sit down. Sit down, you're rocking the boat.
And the devil will drag you under by the sharp lapel of your checkered coat. Sit down, sit down, sit down, sit down.
Sit down, you're rocking the boat.
I sailed away on that little boat to heaven, and by some chance found a bottle in my fist. And there I stood, nicely passing out the whiskey. But the passengers were bound to resist. For the people all said, beware,
people said, you're beware, all right. Beware.
People all said, beware,
people said, beware. Beware.
You'll jump the ship, and the devil will drag you under. By the fence, I run you with your throat. Sit down,
sit down, sit down, sit down, sit down. You're rocking the boat.
And as I laughed at those passengers to heaven, a great big wave came and washed me overboard. And as I sang and I hollered, someone save me, that's the moment I woke up. Thank the Lord.
Thank the Lord. Thank the Lord.
And I said to myself, sit down,
myself, sit down,
you're rocking the boat. Said to myself, sit down,
myself,
sit down, you're rocking the boat. And the devil will drag you under, with a cold so heavy you'd never float. Sit down,
sit down, sit down, sit down,
sit down,
sit down,
you're rocking the boat.
Sit down, you're rocking, rocking the boat. Sit down, you're rocking, rocking the boat. Sit down, you're rocking, rocking the boat. Sit down, you're rocking, rocking the boat. Sit down, you're rocking.
Great, great, great. Well, you know, another great part, it's a supporting part in My Fair Lady, who's actually in about three scenes. One very long scene with Henry Higgins, where he talks about his morality, and the other two great standout performance numbers that are just absolutely outstanding, showing the class, the lower class life in London, and then when he becomes wealthy, what it's like.
The Lord above gave man an arm of iron, so he could do his job and never shirk. The Lord above gave man an arm of iron, but with a little bit of luck, with a little bit of luck, someone else will do the blinking work. With a little bit,
with a little bit, with a little bit of luck you'll never work.
The Lord above made liquor for temptation, to see if man could turn away from sin. The Lord above made liquor for temptation, but with a little bit of luck, with a little bit of luck, when temptation comes, you'll give right in.
With a little bit, with a little bit, with a little bit of luck, you'll give right in.
Oh, you can walk the straight and narrow, but with a little bit of luck, you'll run amok. The gentle sex was made for man to marry, to share his nest and see his food is cooked. The gentle sex was made for man to marry, but with a little bit of luck, with a little bit of luck, you can have it all and not get hooked.
With a little bit, with a little bit, with a little bit of luck, you won't get hooked. With a little bit, with a little bit, with a little bit of blooming luck.
They're always throwing goodness at you, but with a little bit of luck, a man can duck. The Lord above made man to help his neighbor, no matter where, on land or sea or foam. The Lord above made man to help his neighbor, but with a little bit of luck, with a little bit of luck, when it comes around, you won't be home.
With a little bit, 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 the blooming lawn.
Make a good suffragette,
or at least a gas
alarm. Why, there's the lucky man now, the Honorable Alfie Doolittle.
What are you doing in Eliza's house?
A former residence. You can buy your own drinks now, Alfie Doolittle. Fallen into a tub of butter, you have.
What are you talking about?
Your daughter, Eliza. Oh, you're a lucky man, Alfie Doolittle.
Well, what about Eliza?
Ah, he don't know. Her own father, and he don't know. Moved in with a swell, Eliza has. Left her in a taxi, all by herself, smart as paint, and ain't been home for 3 days.
Go on.
Then this morning I get a message from her. She wants her things sent over to 27A, Wimpole Street, care of Professor Regans. And what things does she want?
What?
A birdcage. And a Chinese fan. But she says, never mind about sending any clothes.
I knew she had a career in front of her. Eddie boy, we're in for a booze up. The sun is shining on Alfred P. Doolittle.
A man was made to help support his children, which is the right and proper thing to do. A man was made to help support his children, but with a little bit of luck, with a little bit of luck, they'll go out and start supporting you.
With a little bit, with a little bit, with a little bit of luck, they'll work for you. With a little bit, with a little bit, with a little bit of blooming luck.
Oh, it's a crime for man to go philandering and fill his wife's poor heart with grief and doubt. Oh, it's a crime for man to go philandering, but with a little bit of luck, with a little bit of luck, you can see the bloodhound, don't find out.
With a little bit, with a little bit, with a little bit of luck, she won't find out.
Charlie!
With a little bit, with a little bit, with a little bit of blooming luck. With a little bit of blooming luck.
You certainly see the classism that changes for Alfie Doolittle over time. Another wonderful part is not a big part, but the mayor's wife in The Music Man is a great supporting role, and actresses of an age are thrilled to get it. The Music Man, written by Meredith Willson, of course, recently staged for the first time on Broadway in about 20 years with Hugh Jackman. It's an American favorite.
Your every move bespeaks Delsart. Will you? Will you? Say yes, Mrs. Shin.
Well, that is, dancing well.
Then you accept.
Yes, indeed. And I would like to say...
Oh, thank you, Mrs. Shin.
Oh.
And now the young lady who teaches the piano. Marion Peru, I believe. Well, after all, she is the librarian.
She must have picked him out the first crack out of the box.
Talking up to a man like that.
He wouldn't take and talk up about it.
He didn't take and try turkey talking to him, brazen.
Not to take her ticket and punch it for her.
Picked her out first crack like a cheap jack.
Not much pick to her, if you ask me.
Pick a little, talk a lot.
Pick a little, talk a little.
Cheap, cheap, cheap.
Talk a lot, pick a little more.
Pick a little, talk a little. Pick a little, talk a little. Cheap, cheap, cheap. Talk a lot, pick a little more. Pick a little, talk a little. Pick a little, talk a little. Cheap, cheap, cheap. Talk a lot, pick a little more. Pick a little, talk a little. Pick a little, talk a little. Cheap, cheap, cheap. Talk a lot, pick a little more. Pick a little, talk a little. Pick a little, talk a little. Cheap, 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 cheap.
Professor, her kind of woman doesn't belong on any committee. Of course, I shouldn't tell you this, but she advocates dirty books.
Dirty books?
Chaucer, Rabelais,
Balzac.
And the worst thing, of course, I shouldn't tell you this,
I'll tell.
The man lived on my street. Let me tell.
No, I'll tell. She made brazen overtures to a man who never had a friend in this town till she came here. Old Miser Madison.
Miser Madison?
Miser
Madison.
Madison Picnic Park, Madison Gymnasium, Madison Hospital, that Miser Madison?
Exactly. What did he think he was, anyway?
Well, I should say, the show-off. He gave the town the library, too, didn't he?
That's just it. When he died, he left the library building to the city.
But he left all the books to her.
She was seen going and coming from his place.
Oh, yes, that woman made brazen overtures with a cute-touch guarantee. Should a golden glint in her eye, the silver voice with a counterfeit ring. Just melt her down and you'll reveal a lump of lead as cold as steel here, where a woman's heart should be.
He left River City, the library building, but he left
just a minute here, Professor. Sorry, we need your credentials. Why, certainly, gentlemen. I have just what you want over my hotel. Please come with me. Good night, ladies. Good night, ladies.
Good night, ladies. Good night, ladies. We're going to leave you now. Farewell, ladies. Farewell, ladies. Farewell, ladies. We're going to leave you now.
And then I'm going to end today with, I think, the three greatest small parts ever in a musical. Sondheim wrote this fabulous lyric to the Julie Stein music. And if you got to have a small part in a show...
What is happening on Broadway? Here is our annual look at the state of our theater art. On this program, you will see some wonderful material from... packed SRO shows are now playing Broadway, including Black and Blue, Grand Hotel, City of Angels. And I want you to know this. If you're going to be a stripper, you got to do more than take your clothes off. And if you've seen Gypsy, you know why. Here to perform a number that knocks them out from Gypsy, Anna McNeely, Jana Robbins, and Barbara Irwin are here to say and sing, "You've Got to Have a Gimmick." Welcome them, please.
You're behind till you're banned, but you gotta get a gimmick if you wanna get a hand.
Happened to them.
Sing, you've got a hat.
Favorite number of all. So I hope you all enjoyed the great parts that actors should seek out today. And I'll see you all next Friday. And I'll send out a link with the film from this morning. And we'll see you all again soon. Take care, everybody. I saw there was a comment. Let me just see what the comment was. So I didn't look in the chat. Somehow it's just not. Hold on. Dancing in Ohio, I don't really know anything much about it yet. I'm going to keep on that one because it sounds like it's a very interesting one. I do have tickets coming up, as I said, for Here Lies Love in November. Our October trip to New York, the weekend trip, is all sold out. So I look forward to seeing you all soon. Take care, and have a great week, everybody. Bye-bye.